In 1858, Django, a slave, is chained to a bunch of other slaves and being marched to his new owner's estate in Texas by the Speck brothers. At nightfall, a German man in a dentist cart pulls up and hails the Speck brothers. He introduces himself as Dr. King Schultz. Schultz is clearly more intelligent and enlightened than the Specks. He says he is looking for a slave who can identify a band of wanted fugitives known as the Brittle brothers. Django announces that he knows the Brittle brothers and can identify them. Schultz offers to buy Django, but his polite and educated manner rubs the ill-mannered Specks the wrong way, and Ace Speck threatens to shoot him with his shotgun. In response, Schultz lowers his lantern, whips out a revolver, and shoots Ace, then Dickie's horse, spilling its owner on the ground. The horse carcass then lands on and crushes Dickie's leg, leaving him screaming in pain. Despite Dickie's continued insults and condemnation, Schultz pays the man, for both Django, and the dead Speck's horse, gets an official title to Django. Free, Django approaches Ace's corpse, intending to take the man's clothes and boots. When Dickie berates Django, Django steps heavily on the dead horse, prompting Dickie to scream further. Django takes Ace's boots and clothes and mounts Ace's horse. Before Schultz and Django leave, he frees the remaining slaves and says that they may either carry the remaining Speck brother back to town, or shoot him and flee. As Django and Schultz ride off, we hear Speck pleading for his life. We hear a gunshot and can see blood splatter as Dickie's brains are blown out. Django and Schultz arrive in the small town of Daughtry near El Paso. As they travel through the streets, townspeople stop to stare in disbelief at the sight of a black man on a horse, much to Schultz's confusion. As Schultz ties his cart down at a hitching post, he checks some papers to make sure he's in the right place. The two then walk into a saloon despite the fact that Django is forbidden from doing so. When Schultz insists on being served, the barkeep runs out of the saloon, Schultz calling after him to specifically bring the sheriff, not the town marshal. While they wait, Schultz pours beers for himself and Django and leaves money on the bar. He explains that he is no longer a dentist, but a bounty hunter in search of the Brittle brothers who are wanted dead or alive. He admits that although he knows the general location of the brothers, near Gatlinburg, they have adopted aliases, and he needs somebody who can identify them. Schultz tells Django that if he helps him bring in the Brittle brothers, Schultz will give him his freedom, pay him a $75 share of the reward, and let him keep his horse. Django immediately agrees when, as if on cue, Schultz sees the sheriff coming down the sidewalk. The sheriff enters the saloon, shotgun in hand, and tells Schultz and Django to leave. The two comply and exit out the swinging doors. We see that a number of townspeople are watching the spectacle unfolding as the sheriff asks them why they are coming into his town and showing themselves with the sole purpose of causing trouble. Schultz is silent, then steps forward. A spring-mounted derringer pops up in his right hand, and he shoots the sheriff in the stomach. The townspeople are stunned as the sheriff stumbles to the ground, moaning in pain. Schultz walks around the wounded sheriff, aims his derringer, and shoots him in the head, killing him. The townspeople immediately run for their lives. Schultz looks up and tells the bartender that now is the time to fetch the marshal. The bartender runs off while Schultz and Django go back into the saloon to wait. The town marshal and most of the town arrive and train rifles on the front door of the saloon. Schultz hears that he has 100 rifles aimed at his head and gets the marshal to agree to not have him shot dead like a dog in the street when he comes out. Schultz then exits, hands raised over his head and a paper in his hand. He announces to the marshal and to the assembled townsfolk what has really happened. That the dead man the people of Daughtry elected their sheriff, who went by the name of Bill Sharp, is a wanted cattle rustler named Willard Peck, with a $200 bounty on his head. Schultz says that the paper in his hand is an official document from a judge that charges King with finding and bringing Peck back to the proper jurisdiction dead or alive. Schultz then suggests that the marshal pay him the $200 fee. Later, while camping, Django admits to Schultz that what he wants to do once he is liberated is buy freedom for his wife. A slave girl named Brumhilde von Schaft, who had been a servant of a German mistress before being sold into slavery in the U.S. Django and Schultz eventually develop a plan to infiltrate an estate near Gatlinburg where they suspect that the Brittle brothers reside and for Django to identify them. Django is to play act as a freed slave who has been hired as Schultz's valet. They arrive at the plantation owned by Spencer, Big Daddy, Bennett. Schultz states he is looking to buy one of Bennett's slave girls for an exorbitant price. As he and Bennett talk business, Django is given free range to look around the estate. Django asks Bettina, his escort, if she knows of the Brittles. Bettina admits that she doesn't know them, leading Django to suspect that the Brittles are using a false name. At this, Bettina reveals that three overseer brothers known as the Schaefers did arrive in the past year. She points out the first one in the field. Django looks through his telescope and sees that it is Ellis. Seeing Ellis causes Django to have a lengthy flashback over running away with Brumhilda and pleading with Big John to spare Brumhilda from the whip, unsuccessfully. The flashback ends with Big John saying, "I like the way you beg, boy." Snapping out of his flashback, Django learns that Big John and Little Raj are on a different part of the plantation, about to whip a young slave girl for breaking eggs. The two have tied her to a tree by the arms and Big John is about to use the whip on her when Django appears and shouts Big John's name. Big John turns, stunned to see Django, who suddenly produces a derringer similar to Schultz's and shoots him through a Bible page glued to his shirt. He looks down at his bullet wound as Django tells him, "I like the way you die, boy," and Big John pitches forward dead. Little Raj attempts to grab his revolver, but Django grabs Big John's whip and uses it to viciously flog him. He then takes the gun and unloads it into Little Raj, just as Schultz comes racing in. Django tells Schultz that Ellis is already galloping away across the cotton field. Schultz tracks Ellis through his sniper rifle, and once Django positively identifies the man, Schultz fires. Blood sprays the cotton flowers as Ellis falls off his horse. Though Bennett is incensed when he arrives, he is forced to let them go once Schultz explains they are legally authorized to kill and collect these men. Schultz and Django pack up quickly and leave. That night, out for revenge, Bennett calls out all the fellow white men of the plantation to kill Django and Schultz, spotting their dentist's cart camped outside of town. The men make their charge over the hill in KKK-style hoods and surround the small campsite. The scene then changes to earlier, when Bennett is giving instructions to the other clansmen to not shoot Django or Schultz unless they are shot at. He puts his bag hood on, and a funny scene ensues as Bennett finds he is unable to see through the eye holes in his mask. Everyone else starts to bicker about how badly made their masks are, which ends with Willard, whose wife Jenny spent all afternoon making masks for them, giving up and riding away, furious. Eventually, the clansmen get their act together. As they surround the cart, one of the men spots what he thinks is Django and Schultz hiding under the cart. He peeks under, only to find that the bodies are actually bedrolls. The scene cuts to Django and Schultz hiding in a tree a short distance away, Schultz carrying a rifle, and fires at the cart, setting off a bundle of dynamite hidden in the tooth on the roof of his cart. It blows up and kills most of the clansmen. Bennett manages to survive the detonation and begins riding away. Schultz sees this and hands the rifle over to Django, letting him do the honors. Django tracks, and then fires, hitting Bennett and shooting him off his horse. Schultz realizes that Django is a natural and formidable sharpshooter. King asks what Django will do now that he is officially free, and Django says he will locate his wife and try to purchase her freedom. King, who has bonded with Django and is impressed by both his intelligence and marksmanship, proposes to help Django rescue his wife if Django will work with him over the winter in collecting bounties. Django agrees to King's proposal. King trains Django to not only be an expert with a gun, but also how to read and present himself in public. On one mission, Django and King perch themselves on a hill overlooking a small farm where Django hesitates to kill a man who is now peacefully working on the farm and has a son. King explains that before the man owned this farm and started a family, he murdered several people while robbing stagecoaches, and that he has a $7,000 bounty on his head. King explains that it is this own man's actions in a dirty world that has brought the bounty hunters to his door. Hearing this, Django shoots and kills the man in front of his son. King tells him to keep the wanted poster, as a bounty hunter's first successful poster is good luck. Throughout the winter, Django imagines he and Brimhilda free and happy. Jumping forward to March 1859, once winter passes, the two head back to the south in search of Brimhilda. King discovers that she was sold to a man named Calvin Candie, the owner of a plantation known as Candie Land. Candie is famous for breeding mandingos, slaves who are bred to fight each other to the death for their owner's amusement. King says that he will pose as a wealthy European who seeks to purchase one of Candie's mandingos to take to fight in Europe, and that Django is his business partner and talent evaluator. That evening, Django and King arrive at a Candie's Cleopatra club and they meet Candie's lawyer, Leonine Mowgli, who explains that Candie is obsessed with French culture. The two are brought upstairs where they watch a mandingo fight, which is very brutal and fatal for the loser, who gets his eyes gouged out by the winner and his head caved in with a ball-peen hammer. As Candie congratulates his winning mandingo, the owner of the dead mandingo, an Italian businessman named Amerigo Vespi frets over the loss of his fighter and retires to the nearby bar for a drink. Django introduces himself to Vespi before he walks out. It turns out that Candie is boorish and clearly arrogant and ignorant despite his wealth and high upbringing. Django is incredibly offensive to Candie and his guests, talking back to all the white men. Candie finds Django's rude and defensive behavior amusing and King to be charming. King and Django state that they are willing to pay an exorbitant amount for one of Candie's better mandingos and they arrange to return with him to his estate. The next morning, the group travels in a convoy to the Candyland ranch. Django continues to act defiantly, insulting both slave and white man alike, and displays his intelligence. When King asks Django why he is so belligerent, Django says he is playing his role in this dirty world. Candie states that he believes 1 in 10,000 black men are exceptional, and believes Django to be one of those rare few. At one point on the travel into Candyland, they see one of Candie's slaves chased up a tree by some of Candie's white trash workmen and their vicious hounds. It turns out the slave, D'Artagnan, is a mandingo who was caught running away. Candie convinces D'Artagnan to come down from the tree where D'Artagnan pleads he can't handle any other fights despite having won 3 in a row. Candie states that his slaves can't retire from fighting until they have won at least 5 matches in order for him to recoup his $500 investment in them, and that D'Artagnan must be killed. Schultz suddenly offers to pay Candie $500 to spare D'Artagnan's life, but Django, realizing such odd behavior would blow their cover, loudly declares that D'Artagnan isn't worth a single penny. Schultz, coming to his senses, agrees not to pay for D'Artagnan, and Candie has the slave ripped to pieces by the hounds as they all look on. Django glares at Candie, but imagines himself reunited with Brimhilda to keep his anger suppressed. A little later, they all arrive at Candyland and meet Candy's widowed older sister Lara Lee and his loyal, 76-year-old house slave and foreman trustee Stephen. It is clear that Stephen is appalled that Django is free and riding on a horse into the estate along with his master and other white men and will be allowed to stay in Candy's house. Django also takes an instant disliking to Stephen. Stephen informs Candie that, while he was gone, Brimhilda also attempted to escape and is now locked in the hot box, a metal pit in Candie's field. Schultz says he wants to meet Brimhilda, saying he heard legend of her German-speaking abilities. Candie, wanting to please his guest, orders Brimhilda to be cleaned up and sent to Schultz's room. Though he's enraged at seeing his wife dragged from the hot box, Django checks his temper. When Brimhilda is brought to Schultz's room, the doctor explains to Brimhilda that he and his friend are here to rescue her. He then signals Django to come into his room, and Brimhilda faints with happiness upon seeing her husband. Schultz, impressed with Brimhilda's intelligence, begins the next phase of his plan. That evening at dinner, Brimhilda serves Candie and his many guests, including Schultz and Django. Lara notes that Brimhilda seems to be attracted to Django. This piques Stephen's curiosity, and he begins to interrogate Brimhilda in a back room. Brimhilda denies knowing Django, but Stephen knows that she is lying because she bears the same small R brand, for runaway, on the right side of her face as Django does. Meanwhile, Schultz, despite Django's objections, offers to buy Candie's third best Mandingo for $12,000. They agree that Schultz will return to the estate in 5 days with a lawyer to complete the transaction. Candie, clearly thrilled at this windfall, is then asked by King whether he can also purchase Brumhilda and take immediate possession of her. Before Candie can accept the deal, Stephen interrupts and asks to speak to his master in another room. Once there, Stephen tells Candie that he is convinced that Django and Brumhilda know each other, and that Schultz and Django intend to buy her, leave the property, and never return for the Mandingo. Candie is incensed and returns to the dining room with a small bag containing the skull of an old slave of his plantation, Ben. He then explains that he collects the skulls of his dead slaves and, invoking the pseudoscience of phrenology, has determined that the reason they don't rise up and kill their masters, despite easily outnumbering the whites, is that their brains are predisposed to subservience and civility, whereas white brains are built for dominance and ingenuity. Candie suddenly drops his act, revealing he knows that they want Brumhilda, and unless they immediately pay him $12,000 for her, he will kill her with a ball-peen hammer and examine her skull in front of them. King immediately agrees to these terms, and Candie tells Django that he is not exceptional after all. Schultz pays the $12,000 and Candie has his lawyer, Leonine Mowgli, begin drawing up the papers transferring ownership of Brumhilda to King. Candie gloats about his victory and intelligence, and Schultz begins to think of D'Artagnan's brutal death. The papers are signed, but before they leave, King insults Candy's intelligence, noting how especially stupid Candie is. Since he names his slaves after characters in novels written by Alexandre Dumas, even though Dumas was a black man. Candie, seeking to humiliate Schultz and recognizing that Schultz finds him to be a disgusting human being, says he will not allow the travelers to leave with Brumhilda unless King shakes his hand. A Mississippi and Southern tradition. This is more than Schultz can take. As he stretches out his hand to shake Candy's hand, his spring-loaded pistol pops into his right hand and fires through the flower on Candy's lapel. Candie looks down at the bullet wound, clutches his chest, staggers backwards and falls over, dead. Stephen screams, "No!" and rushes to Candy's side. Butch Pooch, Candy's bodyguard, turns around. Schultz apologizes to Django for being unable to resist temptation, and then Pooch fires his shotgun. The shot hits Schultz with enough force to throw him back into a bookcase, dead. All hell breaks loose as Django grabs the distracted Pooch's revolver and shoots him. Mowgli tries to run, screaming for help, but is shot multiple times as he tries to enter the foyer. Django then is thrown back into the foyer, and a shootout ensues as he trades fire with numerous white ranchers. Despite taking several losses, several reinforcements of white ranchers arrive, armed with repeating rifles, where they use ladders to scale the second floor of the house to gain access and take position atop the second floor balcony, where they open massive return fire against the lone Django, who is forced to take cover under some furniture. The shootout ends when Django runs out of ammo while Stephen and Billy Crash capture Brumhilda and threaten to kill her unless Django agrees to Stephen's terms of surrender. Feeling that he has no other choice, Django acquiesces and is brutally beaten by Candy's crew. When Django awakens several hours later the next morning, he is naked and tied upside down in a shack. Billy Crash is preparing to castrate him with a red-hot knife. Stephen enters and tells the man that the plans have changed, and Django is no longer slated for castration. After the man leaves, Stephen explains that Django would have died too quickly if he had been castrated. Stephen, wanting Django to suffer, has arranged to sell him to the Luquint Dickey Mining Company as a slave, where Django will spend the rest of his days. En route to the mining company, Django is able to get the attention of one of the transporters. He tells them that he is a bounty hunter, not a slave, and that he was tracking a man worth $7,000 before he was captured. He promises that if they free and arm him, he will give them the lion's share of the reward. They find the bounty notice on his person and also question the other slaves, who admit that Django is a bounty hunter and rode into Candyland with a white man on a horse. The transporters unwisely free Django, give him a pistol, and he immediately kills them all and frees the other slaves bound for the mine. He takes a horse, guns, and dynamite and heads back to Candyland. Django first stops and massacres all of the surviving ranch hands who had hunted down the escaped D'Artagnan with their hounds, killing them all in D'Artagnan's name. He then finds King's dead body in a stable with the freedom papers for Brumhilda still on him. After he takes the papers, Django swears that his next act of vengeance will be in honor of King. Django sneaks back onto the estate and finds and frees Brumhilda. He has her wait outside Candyland while he engages in further preparations. That evening, Candy's family and friends return from Candy's funeral. Django is there waiting at the top of the grand staircase and shoots Billy Crash and the last two white ranch hands dead. Django even shoots Lara, sending her sprawling backwards and out of sight, despite that she is unarmed. After telling the two female house slaves to leave, Django then shoots Stephen in both of his kneecaps, stating that, in the 9,999 slaves Stephen has likely betrayed while working for Candy. He has never met one like Django. Django lights a fuse and walks out on Stephen. The explosion utterly destroys Candy's mansion as Stephen still threatens Django. Django meets his wife, who waits for him with two horses outside the estate. The two are finally reunited and ride off into the night to face whatever destiny awaits them. Django is destined to become a legend, just as Siegfried before him did. After the end credits, we cut to the slaves Django freed from the mining company transporters. They remain seated where Django left them. Then, one asks what the name of that black man was, suggesting Django may not yet become a legend.